Our next presenter is George Roskos, a friend of mine, just like Mike's a good friend of mine. He's a Grammy-nominated entrepreneur, artist manager, and owner of Architekt Music, which is a recording studio, live music venue, music educator, and artist management company based out of Butler, New Jersey. Architekt was founded in late 2009 and currently operates two locations in North Jersey. George has managed Seven Dust, Thank You Scientist, 3 Years Hollow, Jared Wall, and mixing engineer Mike Ferretti. What a coincidence, right? Additionally, his popular music industry podcast, All Access, with George Roskos, was launched in 2016, which I'm a huge fan of. I drive a lot, so I listen to George all the time. So, George Roskos.
Thanks, man. How's everybody doing? I'm the last talking head today, so I'll try to make it quick and impactful. So, what he just said, I'm not one of those scumbag managers. I think I'm a pretty nice one. Right, AJ? I'm not too bad, right? Cool. Awesome. Let me just make sure I know where I'm at on my time here. Perfect. So I'm a little bit different. You know, for me today, I like context. So if anybody has, you know, questions or anything, just interject. I'm cool with that. For me today, I mean, the one thing, I've kind of experienced a lot of the different roles in the industry. And what's interesting about the way I kind of set up my talk today for you guys was about self-awareness. And as I was sitting here listening to everybody else speak today, I realized that everything that they were saying and all of the different paths that they took were relevant to me. Like, just for example, like, I realized that my first job out of college was working for retail. I worked for Shure Microphones. Like, you know, what Troy had said about Yamaha, I related to all that. I went to NAMM for sure. That's where I started. Then I went into concert promoting. That was what was exciting to me. And my journey took me through self-awareness in every little bump along the way, realizing what my value was. And I realized that my value wasn't in retail. It's not what fulfilled me. It just wasn't there. My value wasn't in being a concert promoter. When I opened a studio, I own a music business, so we have a music education facility. We have like 300 weekly students. We have two locations. We have a live venue. It's like 120 cap rooms, kind of like the size of this. And we have a recording studio. So I was in a rock band. I was a drummer. And I thought, man, we're going to make it. I'm going to be a drummer. This is going to be awesome. And I did that. And I worked at a studio in New Jersey, and I met this guy, Mike Ferretti, who was working at the studio, who you heard from earlier today. And I said, you know what? I said to my business partner, Kurt, who I met in college, I said, dude, let's open a studio and let's steal this guy. And we did. So, right, where's Mike? I don't know where he's at. But, oh, there he's in the back. But that's what we wanted to do. You know, we went out and we convinced two banks that we would be profitable, which was totally ridiculous. We ended up being profitable, but you know, and then we ended up stealing Mike. And the goal there was, you know, we want to own a recording studio and do it better than these folks. So then I realized with self-awareness that, you know what, my value isn't being a drummer. It's not what actually fulfills me. I want to work for this guy. I want to book this guy. I want to make my studio busy and book his time. And when did we start that? 2010, 2011? So we're going on year 7 of me working with Mike. And then he ended up being my first management client. And then I fell into management. And that's kind of where my journey is now, 5-6 years later. I was a studio manager for a while with Mike, artist manager. And then I moved into artist management. It was a complete accident. So I just started hustling. I met Seven Dust on Twitter. The guitar player put up a thing about needing some studio monitors. I replied, hey, I work for KRK and Shure. I'll send you some studio monitors. And they were one of my favorite bands, and the relationship just kind of snowballed. Because I'm just kind of good at the relationship thing and building that and providing value. You know, he would need flights. I'd book his flights. I wouldn't pay for them, don't get crazy. But just being a helpful person, you know, it kind of started this snowball for me. And through my business, I just became an artist manager, and eventually Seven Dust left this big corporate management firm to come work with a 25-year-old nobody, because I was a bulldog, and I was doing stuff for them that nobody had ever done before at a price that it's never been done for. And that's, for me, is not only the self-awareness, but the value proposition in that. You know, giving more than you take. I find so many people, even interns that come to the studio, even people that want to work with the band or with me, they ask for so much. And it's like, I feel the same way about myself right now. Nobody owes me anything. You don't owe me your attention. You don't owe me your time. You don't owe me anything, right? Like, I have to convince you to listen, right? I have to convince you to give a damn. That's here right now. But in any business, if you're asking someone for an internship or a job, they don't owe you that. And there's something so beautiful in that, because that's trust building, that's relationship building, that is the foundation of everything that we're doing. And there's nothing harder than the music business. You know, it's sexy. What's sexier than the music business? Nothing. You know, it's one of the hardest businesses to work in, but it's also one of the easiest to break through if you give value, if you have a real value proposition. You know, everybody's experienced that aha moment of, holy shit, this guy really, really loves me because I'm giving more than I'm taking back. I'm giving something without asking for it, you know, without asking for a reward or something back. And there's incredible value in that. And that's relationship building. That's how you get the snowball going. And that's how I ended up with a career band that had no business manager. I was just a good pretender, you know. I can do it, and then I'd run away, like, holy shit, I don't know how to do this right now, but I'm going to figure it out, man. I'm going to figure it out. So I think I saw a question. Yeah. Yeah. I think that's a great question. I'll go artist management, because that's more my speed than the label thing. I mean, the artist management thing, it's tough, because I describe it, especially when you're working with a band who's actually doing it successfully, like for a living, it's kind of like herding cats. You know, like it's literally like chasing cats around. And I don't mean that, I'm not trying to be facetious, it just is that in their nature, and I'm not putting them down, but it's just kind of that mentality of just, you're always like, holy shit, I got everybody's not on the same page, and the singer hates the guitar player today, and the drummer doesn't know what he's doing, and he can't find his credit card, and what's his social security number, and oh my God, where's the airline? Is he gonna miss his flight? He missed his car, and it's like, that's every day. That's just, I mean, and that's just a taste of it. You know, and then trying to get them in the studio with a guy like Mike and create together, like coexisting together in a bus is hard enough. And then get them to create. I mean, I feel bad for Mike, 16 hours a day nonstop, it's just atrocious. But, you know, organizationally, the thing that you need to do is put really good people around you. And I think that you got to focus on your strengths and not worry about your weaknesses. You know, fill in the gaps with people who can, you know, enrich you and vice versa. So, you know, I'm not very good at, because I just don't care about budgeting and stuff. So that's a good example of, like with an artist, I do not want to deal with a tour budget. I don't want to look at one. I don't want to think about one. I just don't care. If it's bad, I'll talk to the artist about it. If it's great, I'll really talk to the artist about it. But like that's an example of putting good people around you, or even in my office. I hate dealing with social media. I mean, that's a ridiculous thing to say as an artist manager, but that's kind of like a crucial part of everything that we do, right? So it's having somebody in the office who's killer at that, you know, who's better at that than I am. And that's something for you guys. I mean, I don't sit around and worry about my weaknesses. I just don't care. And I don't mean that arrogantly. What I mean is I really focus on my strength. I put 80% of my energy into the 20% of things that I'm really great at. And then everything else, I fill in those gaps with people around me. And I'm blessed to do that. I'm in a great position that I have a wonderful team of people. But even when I wasn't financially capable of doing that, I relied on my partner. I relied on guys like Mike for their skill sets. You know, and I think that's just a way that you build a great organization with a tour manager who can really run a great tour. You know, great accountants, great attorneys. And as a manager, it's just running that organization. It's just making sure that all the people are doing exactly what they need to do, providing support to them. And for me, the biggest part was keeping the band together. That's every day of my life is just keeping the band as happy and healthy as they can be. So a lot of my job is just being a psychiatrist, you know, kind of like what Mike talked about. And on a very macro level, you know, really big picture, but also on a very micro level. You know, like the guitar player slammed the door last night at 2 a.m. on the bus and woke us all up. Like, you know, that's a phone call I get. You know, the tour manager said I was a dick. Okay, I'm sorry you said that. Like, let's talk about it. You know, you are a dick. I mean, let's just be real. Let me see where I'm at on time here. Hey, what time do you want me to go to? Yeah? Okay, cool. So the other thing that I think is really important, I don't know what the oldest age of like a student is in here. What is it, like 20, 21, something like that? 22? So I'll tell you where I was at as a 22-year-old, and we'll see if you guys relate to it. But you know, by the time I was graduating college, I was already freaking out that I didn't have everything figured out. You know, I didn't have a career figured out, a job figured out. No one was taking my emails or my phone calls because they didn't owe me anything, and I didn't figure that out then. I figured that out later. But the thing I think is interesting, and what I love about what everybody said today, all the speakers said, is if you think about it, every single one of them had a phenomenal journey of just, you know, ebb and flow and figuring out their way. And every person in this room who hasn't started that journey yet, you're going to have a journey. So sitting here today, or when you graduate in next month, I guess. Seniors are graduating next month, right? Yeah, seniors. Yeah, man, yeah, yeah. We're going out in the real world. It sucks. No. You know, the really important thing is to just be mindful that you're just beginning. I mean, I just turned 30 2 weeks ago, and I feel like I haven't done it enough. At times, I feel like I've done too much because I have no social life. But, you know, really, I'm at the early part of my journey, too. So in 7 or 8 years, you know, those are the things that I chose to go after and accomplish. And you guys are going to leave here, and it's just starting. You're just beginning. So I you're at the most beautiful point in your life. If you're mindful of those things and you're really, really tenacious and you're ready to put yourself out there for little to nothing, as little as you can manage, you will succeed. You know, because standout people in this industry are really, really hard to find. We had a couple of great speakers today. These guys are standout people. You know, these folks are standout people. And you can be stand-up, because there's, for every one of those guys, I'm not going to include myself, but every person that spoke here today that's successful, or a guy like AJ, there's 100 people who are lazy and don't really give a damn about anybody but themselves. They just do it because the business is sexy. You know, the music business is so awesome in theory, but it's so hard in practice. Because if you're a good accountant or a great accountant, what's really the difference? You know, no offense to accountants. All right, good. Accountants suck. But but if you're a great artist manager versus a good artist manager, that's the world difference. If you're a great engineer like Mike Ferretti, or you're a good one, there's miles of difference there. You know, and even Mike, I mean, he's a great example. You know, what he has done with his career, he's, what, Mike, 33, 32? Early 30s? You know, he has accomplished so much, but he's put in so much time. I mean, think about when he was saying he worked with Breaking Benjamin. 2006? It's 11 years. You know, and we both got our first Grammy nomination last February, a year ago. You know, and it's like, that's a hell of a long time. You know, and I feel like we're both just starting our journeys. You know, so it's, you know, I think the patience thing is just so, so important, because if you lose sight of that and you get in your head and you get emotional and you get angry and you get jealous, that's a deal breaker. And then you're going to go from great to poor real quick. And then you're going to be out of the industry, you know, doing things you don't want to be doing. You know, so for me, I'd rather be broke and happy than rich and miserable. That's just me. A lot of my friends would rather work on Wall Street, be miserable as hell, do way too much cocaine, not joking, and be rich. And they all drive Maseratis, and they hate their lives. I mean, I just, that's not me. And I think that anybody in here, I would hope, relates to that. You know, that's why we're here. I mean, it's beautiful, right? Like, if you could wake up, you know, Mike said, everybody said it today. If you could wake up and love what you do, there's nothing better than that. Forget the paycheck, it's gonna come. Forget the paycheck. You'll make your bills happen. If you're tenacious enough to make it in the music industry, you'll find a way to pay your bills. I mean, it just is what it is. Get it done. Just get it done. You know? What am I out of time? How am I doing, AJ? Whoa. Counter. How am I doing? 5 minutes? All right. Anybody else have any questions? Any context you want to kind of drive it? All right, cool. What? Did I miss one? Hey, sorry, what's up, dude?
I'm sorry, I heard you say that you, something about Architekt and Butler.
Yeah, that's me.
Yeah, I played there a long time ago.
Really?
Yeah,
in the venue?
I had no idea you could be.
Yeah, that's us, man.
Yeah.
Yeah. Did you have a good experience or a bad one? Let's only talk if you had a good one. Was it right?
It was good.
That's good. he definitely, like, hesitated. You see that? I'm like, oh my God, it's gonna be bad. It's gonna ruin everything. What else did I want to hit here? Let me just make sure that I got everything that I wanted to hit with you guys. Let's just go back to self-awareness for 1 second. I think this is a good way to end it. You know, I think listen, we're in the social media world. I told you that how much I dislike it and how necessary it is. So let's talk about like Snapchat and Instagram and Facebook and stuff, right? So like, I'm sure there's some people in this room, so I'm about to call you out real hard, okay? And Mike loves this example. Mike, I'm gonna give him the console example. Did you ever have that guy who like went to a studio for a day and he takes like the picture in front of the console, and it's like this picture, in front of the recording console, and then that's just like his profile photo for 6 years? It's like, dude, you were in the studio for one day. Like, come on. And, you know, the people that put up every day, like, man, I'm hustling. Man, doing it. Yeah, success. And they're putting up quotes. You know, like, they're putting up, like, Tony Robbins quotes about money and success and happiness. It's like, this dude is on the computer way too much to actually be hustling. So I'm going to call everybody out in this room. I'm going to call myself out. You are not working as hard as you think you are. You are not working as hard as you think you are. Because if you have time for all that, you have time for video games and going out for beers with your friends and pizza, you're still in college, so it's kind of okay still. But when you get out of college, you know, it's all about the time you put in. If you have a job, there's another 8 to 10 hours a day to do exactly what you want to do while you figure it out. You know, if you're going to work 8 to 4, you work at Enterprise, Rent-A-Car, or McDonald's, or Starbucks, or Target, wherever you may work, there's another 8 to 10 hours in that day before you need to go to bed and get 6 to 8 hours of sleep that you can be doing exactly what you want to do to build your life. And if you have time for Instagram and Facebook and Xbox and, you know, smoking too much weed, whatever you do, I mean, you're just full of shit. You're just not working as hard as you think you are. And the biggest indicator is that you're putting up statuses about hustling, you know, or how hard you work, or how you're getting it done, or how you're going to make it. And it's like, talk is cheap, man, you know. So just be mindful of that. I just think that anybody who thinks they're working as, you know, super, super hard and is able to have time for all those things isn't doing it. And if you want to succeed, that's where it counts. Because if you show up harder and earlier and faster and better, you know, those are cliche buzzwords, but they're real true. You know, that's exclusive. My intelligence is not what has gotten me, you know, a living over the past few years where I've gotten in my career. My intelligence, I'm not that smart. I'm just tenacious. And I give it more than anybody else that does what I do. So those are my strengths, and I don't focus on the weaknesses, and you shouldn't either. And it's been a real pleasure talking to you guys today. I thank you so very much for having me. I'm sorry if I cursed too much. Did I curse too much? All right. AJ's heard much worse from me.
Just the right amount of cursing. Thanks, George. In the meantime, I have to take down my Tony Robbins quote from Facebook.
What?
I have to take down my Tony Robbins quote from Facebook.
About success.
Yeah, about success. George and Mike work with my good friends, Thank You Scientists, too. Check them out. They're amazing.